So I'm thinking about hardware devices, essentially physical representatives of these cloud services, which makes them actually very different than traditional consumer electronics. So historically, a company made an electronic product, you know, say a turntable, and then they found people who would sell it for them. Then they advertised it heavily, and people bought them. And that was the end of their relationship with that customer until they were able to convince that person to buy another one. So that is the entire value of that relationship had to be packaged within the device itself, which is, you know, my pet theory is that that's why they used to put like heavy metal plates in a consumer electronics so they would feel like you were getting more value out of them. With the Internet of Things, the sale of the device is actually just the beginning of the relationship. It's not the end of the relationship. It's the beginning of the relationship. And the physical thing actually holds almost no value for either the consumer or the manufacturer. Value now shifts to services and the devices, the software applications, and, you know, the websites, the apps that are used to access it. I call those things avatars. They're physical representatives of a thing that's up in the clouds, right? So I also want to steal it back from the VR people. That was totally wrong. So anyway, so a camera becomes a really good appliance for taking photos for Instagram. A TV becomes a really nice way to display Instagram photos that you don't have to log into every time and you can show people at a party. A phone becomes a really convenient way both to take photos and to check your friends' photos, photo streams, or Kanye's when you're on the road. Hardware, the physical things in this situation become simultaneously more specialized and devalued as people see through each device to the service it represents. People don't care about the device, they care about the service. The avatars exist in order to get better value out of the service. Amazon really gets this. So, you know, here's a telling older ad from Amazon for the Kindle. What it's saying is, look, use whatever device you want. We don't care as long as you stay loyal to our service. You can buy one of our specialized devices that we lose money on every time on purpose because the value is in the service. But you can use some other way to access our service and then we won't have to lose money on the device. When Fire was launched, and it was originally Kindle Fire, now you know you have Fire Stick and Fire Phone, that, you know, RIP, not really in IP. But anyway, those of you who, two of those who get that joke. Anyway, so when Fire was released, Bezos even called it a service. It is not a device. It is not a thing. It is a service. Amazon Dash is a service that's enabled by dedicated devices. So this is a real thing. So you can buy a washing machine from Whirlpool or GE that will reorder its own supplies. It will reorder its own Tide when it's running out of Tide. It will reorder its own bleach when it's running out of bleach. You can buy this today. This is enabled by Amazon's Dash service. And the reason that Amazon made this is so that they wouldn't have to make these devices. You know, shipping all that metal is really expensive. Why should we making it? Why should we take the hit on doing the R&D for a washing machine when we can take all the profit by selling the Tide? So Amazon also, for things that don't speak the Amazon Dash service, they'll sell you a button for it. So here's a Tide button. This is a networked computer that you can buy for $5, whose entire purpose is to order you Tide. Every single time you push the button, it will order you Tide, and only Tide. Here, you can pass it around. Don't be ordering me Tide, my... if you look here, you can't see, so the top one, the top one is macaroni and cheese. The bottom one is mince. These are services that are effectively preparing you for infinitely automatically replenishable macaroni and cheese. It's a macaroni and cheese service that you will buy into so you never have to think about buying macaroni and cheese again. The margins on this are insane. So most large-scale Internet of Things products are service avatars like this. They use specialized sensors and actuators to support a service, but they have very little value or they don't even work at all without the supporting service. Like, it's just like your phone. Your phone, if you cancel your contract, doesn't really work. I mean, the Wi-Fi works, but, you know, theoretically, it doesn't really work. When SmartThings was acquired by Samsung, they clearly state their service offering up front and tell you very little about what the stuff does. What the service offers is that they will help you be home wherever you are. They don't tell you how. That's what they're going to do. What does their hardware do? You don't know. You don't care. You shouldn't care. Compare that to X10, their spiritual predecessor who's been around since the Tandy color computer. All X10 tells you about its white plastic boxes is what they are, not what they will accomplish for you. Like, I don't even know if there is a service. Why should I care that they have modules? What the fuck? I don't, and I shouldn't, and I don't. So I think that the real value the connected services offer is their ability to make sense of the world on our behalf, to reduce cognitive load by enabling people to interact with the world, with devices at a higher level than simple data, than simple telemetry, at the level of intentions and goals rather than data and control. Humans are not built to make sense of huge amounts of data across many devices or to articulate our needs as systems of mutually interdependent components. Computers are great at all that shit.